Hello everyone, welcome to our Egyptian online seminar group. First, keep your microphones off. Then if you have any questions, you can ask our speaker during his presentation or after his presentation. I have great pleasure of welcoming Professor Jan Bons. Jan is a professor of accounting at the University of Amsterdam. His previously appointment was at the Cambridge Judge Business School and Tolberg University, where he was head of the accounting department for 7 years. He was visiting professor at Harvard Business School. His research focused on motivating employees with target and selected performance measurements. He has been published on top ranking journals in accounting, such as the Accounting Review, Accounting Organization and Society, Journal of Accounting and Economics, Journal of Accounting Research, Contemporary Accounting Research, Management Science. Now we will start our seminar with Professor Jan.
Well, thank you very much, Mohamed, and thank you for inviting me for this. I think you pulled off a great seminar series all over the world. Great job. Thank you very much for that. And again, thank you for inviting me. And thank you for all the people that are joining today. It's a great pleasure to present this paper. And please feel free to interrupt me at some point where you think this is something that I do not quite agree with or do not quite follow. And please elaborate. Please let me know, because it's a working paper, so we are still looking for improvements. So what is this paper about? This is a paper where we try to understand target setting, but target setting in a very special mode, namely in a firm's hierarchy. And why do we think that is something that is interesting? And this is a paper that is a joint paper with that I write with Christian Hofmann and Nina Schweiger, both from the Ludwig Maximilian University of Munich. And I can tell it's a great pleasure to work with them. So here we go. Why do we think this is important? Well, if you think of superiors setting targets for their agents, that target setting is a process where they try to set as accurate possible targets that people can achieve, which means that they should not be too difficult. But also not too easy. And then we will look at that more in detail in a few minutes. The research that has looked into this relationship between the superior setting a target and the agents for which the target is set, that mainly focuses actually on this manager or this employee, this agent, the individual agent, or at several agents. So it looks like this, right? So it looks either at this level, this is the agent, or at multiple agents. That is what the research has been looking at until now. But if you look at organizations, almost all organizations, even the ones that are getting flatter, are in the end organized as a hierarchy. And that's where our research question starts, right? So how do the supervisor performance affect her method of target setting for her agents, right? So if there's, so it's a supervisor who perform, there's a supervisor who performs herself. And she wants to, of course, perform as good as possible. So how does that consideration that she wants to perform as good as possible affect the target setting for her agents? So we look at this level, the supervisor who sets a target for her agent. And you see above here, there's even one more layer, which is the principal, the highest principal in the firm. But we are mostly interested in this relationship. We will talk a little bit about this highest principal, but that is not the focus of this paper. So why is it interesting? So we look mainly on the decision influencing role of information that is used to set these targets. So the supervisor uses information for the target setting process. And what we try to understand here is it the case that dependent on her own performance, that is going to affect the method of how she sets the target? So specifically what we're going to look at is into, you know, is it the case that the supervisor, when she performs well or not that well, that is going to affect how she sets the target for her agents? And specifically, you know, is it the case that supervisors establish the targets for their agents differently, conditional on her own achievements? And another part of the study, what we think is important too to consider is, you know, there was this literature back in the 1970s, so very long ago, that talked about contagion, and that was actually introduced by Anthony Hopwood. And so his idea was that, you know, if you are set a very difficult target, you will, you know, pass that on. And in this paper, we look at, you know, is that the case? Do you pass on a difficult target that you are set, you know, at a high level to a lower level? So before we go into this hierarchy question, we first have to look back at you know, what is actually a good target? And when you have performance levels here at the y-axis and target difficulty at the x-axis, right, you can set target levels at more difficult levels, right? So, but what do you try to achieve with these targets? You try to achieve with these targets that you motivate the agent to work as hard as possible in the right direction on the right activities. And also you want to actually make sure that you are that the creativity level of that agent is also incentivized so that he or she does his best. So what happens if you set a target extremely difficult, right? People will not feel that they are able, even if they do their best, that they will achieve the target. So they will not work that hard. And that's why performance tapers off here. If you set a very easy target, like on this side, right, then you also are not going to really get the best effort out of your agent, because in that case, you know, it's very easy to achieve the target. So why would the agent work harder? So you are aiming at this type of level, and that's the optimum. And the key thing is, you know, to find that optimum. And you know, this has been established in previous literature that this is a sort of ideal. And actually, there's like 400 papers that are experiments, I should say, that are being published in many, many journals that have established that a target should not be too difficult. So not like this, but also not very easy, but actually should aim at this level. So the art is, you know, where do I find this particular level? And that is what target setting tries to do, using as much as possible information that exactly establishes where you should aim with the target for each individual agent. That question becomes even a little bit more difficult when we think of this in a hierarchy. Because in the hierarchy, you know, the principal needs to set a target that, you know, elicits that level of performance. And at the same time, the supervisor has to do the same. Because if you do not set these types of targets for both levels, right, you do not get the best out of it at the firm level. Out of the agents and the supervisors. So the aim is actually to set targets that are sufficiently difficult, not so easy for the supervisor as well as for the agent. So when you think of that setting, sorry.
Bro, yeah? Question from Professor Steven Saltero.
Yes, please, Steven. Hello, nice that you are here.
Oh yeah, then I just put it in the chat for later.
Okay.
It, yeah. but we'll just leave it.
Okay, well, we'll talk about it later. So when we think of the setting, right? In the setting that we look at, is that the principal sets a target for the supervisor at this level, who then decides how she, so the supervisor, is going to allocate that target over her agents. In the setting that we study, it's a zero-sum game. So if we just sum the targets of the agent, that is equal to the target that is set for the supervisor. So that's a zero-sum game. The supervisor, you know, observes the agent's output and reports about her and her agent's performance to the principal. That is the setting what we are looking at. The supervisor has superior information on the individual agent's performance potential, and the supervisor sets targets for her agents. Now, since the supervisor performance depends on her agent's performance, right, she increases her chances of achieving her target if she can elicit the best effort from her agents, like in the picture that I showed, not too difficult, not too easy. So this best effort is achieved, in other words, when she sets difficult but attainable targets. Missing her target then, if she misses her target, that would indicate that she sets a target that does not elicit this best effort. So a supervisor, so the middle manager in our picture, when she is not achieving her target, if she misses her target, she needs to reconsider, you know, what targets she has set for her agents. And she must be prepared to decrease the targets for underperformance in that case, right? And what is then a natural point of reference? A natural point of reference is when she decides that until now her target setting approach has not resulted in setting a target that people could achieve, right? Her natural fallback would then be, right, just to look at, you know, what were my managers capable of achieving in the past? And that is actually the hypothesis that we test. If she's not able to achieve her target, the supervisor, that suggests that she doesn't set the right targets for her agents. So she needs to reconsider that. And her best reference point to decide, you know, what kind of target that they can achieve is then to look at past performance. And so that is what we test. So we look at, you know, is it the case that the supervisor is going to more strongly incorporate the agent's previous period performance? So what did they achieve in the past? When she missed her own target or not. So that's what we study. So this is how it looks like from a theoretical point of view. So we look at the supervisor's target achievement. How, to what extent did she achieve her target? And is that going to affect the role that past information plays in setting the target? Well, from the target setting literature, we know that underperformers, that their target is not immediately in the next period adjusted at the level that she achieved in the past. In many cases, that is actually ignored. In many cases, it is ignored. So sometimes this line is a straight line, a horizontal line like this. But to quite an extent, it is ignored. So at least there's a kink in this, right? We also call this asymmetric ratcheting, that we increase the target and we hardly decrease the target in the next period. So this is what we find in previous literature. What we are looking at here, what we are examining here, is that if it is the case that a supervisor does not achieve her target, do we then see a movement that is moving in the direction of this straight line? In other words, are we going from here to here? So that is what we try to study here. Is that the case, right? So what is the research sample and site that we are looking at? So what we are looking at is a big service firm, and it's a division of a listed corporation headquartered in Germany. And we are looking at three hierarchical layers with headquarters, which we call the principal previously, five geographical regions, which are the supervisors. And the supervisors are agents to the principal, of course, but you know, supervisors of the agents below them. And we have 30 subsidiaries or agents that we are looking at. Altogether, we have 2,160 subsidiary months observations from one division over the period of 2011 until 2016. This is a seasonal business. There's strong cost savings pressure in that firm coming from this listed firm. And they have actually also quite extensive growth targets. Again, this corporation. We have regional and subsidiary managers who have explicit incentives to meet their targets. There's a fixed bonus of 10 to 50% of the salary in case of target achievement. What they also have is like many face-to-face meetings with regions to generate, you know, like that generates, we argue, implicit incentives. So how does the target setting process look like? If people have questions, please feel free to ask, because maybe I'm going too quick or just let me know. So how does the target process look like? And you know, we're looking at this three-layer hierarchy. So we start from the head office. The head office, the headquarters of our division, right? They get to hear what their target is for the next year, for the full next year. And in that process, headquarters has very little say about, you know, whether this is feasible or not. They more or less get this imposed on them. So this is what happens at the headquarters level of our particular division. And that target is based on the overall firm target. Then in the second stage, it is the case that the controlling department of our division, so at headquarters, they derive a region and subsidiary level targets, year targets, using information on the overall target, market developments, regulation, because it is a little bit of a regulated industry, historical performance information at the region and subsidiary level. And to establish that the right level, they are going to look at, there's a high information, intensive information exchange between headquarters, regional managers, and between regional managers and sub-managers. Where does it lead to, that stage two? In the stage two, what this leads to in the end is that we have a final annual target for the regional manager. So that is a fixed target. Nothing can be changed in that particular target anymore. For the subsidiaries, they get also a year target, but their target can still be twisted. But given that the regional target is already set and cannot be changed, right? If a target becomes easier for one subsidiary manager, it has to become more difficult for another subsidiary manager. There's no escape for that. And it's actually the regional manager in relation to the subsidiary manager that decides on that. So if we sum the subsidiary targets, there that will get us to the regional target. And again, this subsidiary target can still be changed even if the regional target has been established and fixed, cannot be changed anymore. So that is the stage two. Stage three is that that the target for the subsidiary has to be set and fixed, and that is based on discussions between the regional manager and the subsidiary manager again. And sometimes this leads to a reallocation of these targets. And in the end, the subsidiary and the regional manager sets a target for the subsidiary and sets that target for each particular month. So the year target is also then divided into monthly targets based on what they expect will be in each of these particular months. The demand and that they should be able to fulfill. So this is how the target process looks like. Starting from the top level, so the corporation is imposing a target basically on this on our division, and then the headquarters of that division is going to decide what is going to be the target for the region, and in the process also for the subsidiaries. But you know, this target for subsidiaries and for the region is heavily discussed between headquarters and the subsidiary. And after that discussion, the target is made definitive for the subsidiary. Plus that the target, they set a monthly target that takes into account in pounds the seasonal demand shifts that you see over time in each particular month. So
yes, Jan, please. I have a question.
Hey Harry, how are you? Good to see you.
Good to see you. So you mentioned about reallocation of targets among subsidiaries.
Yes.
I wonder if all the subsidiaries or majority of the subsidiaries find it easy to achieve the target, or they find it difficult to achieve the target. Does the top management or the firm revises the targets of regional managers? Because it could be the case that the regional targets are set at a level which makes it easier or harder for the subsidiaries to achieve. So you mentioned only about the case where some subsidiaries find it easy and some subsidiaries find it difficult to achieve the target.
So the target, in the way that it is set, right, it is more or less imposed on the regional manager from the firm level. So it is imposed, and whether that leads to a more or less difficult target for the subsidiaries. There's quite a lot of subsidiaries that are unable to actually achieve that target. So it is definitely not the case that the managers think it is easy to achieve. It's definitely not easy to achieve the target for all subsidiaries.
So there is no revision of targets at the regional manager's level from the firm
within the year? No,
not within the year, at different times, maybe
at different times. Yes. Okay. So at different times, yes. So targets are revised over the years, but not within the year.
But the subsidiary targets are revised within a year, or they are also not revised within a year?
Once they are set, so once we are at this stage three, at the end, that is going to be the target for the rest of the year.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. There's a question of Timothy. Timothy, hello.
Actually, I think Stephen was ahead of me if he wants to jump in.
Steve, please.
Yeah, I want to get a couple of clarifications in here. First of all, is this a meet target, don't meet target bonus setting? In other words, that even though you portray it as the standard kink bonus, compensation. So far, what I've heard you say is that if you meet target, you get a percentage bonus. If you don't meet target, you don't get anything. Is that correct?
That is correct, yes.
Okay. Yeah. And second is, given that that this process must lead to distributive negotiations between the supervisor and the manager. So in other words, the firm is explicitly leaving out any possibility for within-year development of win-win strategies, because they're assuming that the annual target is fixed, and therefore there must be, if there's a decrease in target for one subsidiary manager, there must be an increase in the for others. Do they realize what they are doing? Is that an explicit managerial choice that they're setting up that dynamic within their firm?
They do that on purpose. Actually, we interviewed them on that particular point that you are making, that things might develop in a way that would lead them to change these targets. They fear that if they would allow that to happen, right, that actually leads to so much influencing that is not, I mean, that is not worth their while doing. Yeah. Timothy, you want to go ahead? Yes.
Hi. So my question maybe should have been asked more when we were back at the theoretical level. So we have a principal set a target for a manager, and H1 said if the manager didn't fit it, then it was adjusting the targets for its underlying employees. Isn't the implicit assumption there that the principal had a perfectly rational target if the manager is going to adjust it at that point?
Like the point in time that they make that adjustment is not in the current period, but it's actually in the next period. So after the full realization of the state of affairs have manifested itself over the year, right? That's where negotiations start again, also between the region and headquarters. And that is what we are interested in. So from that we get a new target for the region coming about, and how is that going to affect the target setting method, if you like, that the supervisor adopts? Is he then sticking to the idea that, you know, if you did not make it to the target in the past, right, I'm not going to put too much emphasis on that. I'm going to use other information, if you like, to set that target. Or is it the case that actually this past performance is going to be leading in how they will set the next period target for their agent?
Yeah, I understand the timeline. I'm asking, what if headquarters sets an unreasonable target and you fail to make it? A rational manager may not try to up the target on the subsidiaries, because that would have you on the right-hand side of the peak. They may actually go backwards, in that maybe they won't hit the hurdle, but at least they'll do better with, you know, operating income. That was just, so it seems the assumption is the principal has to be perfectly rational in setting the targets for H1 to be. Yeah. And my other questions, more big picture.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
And the thing is, the principal does not allow that, because they just say, well, you know, the sum of the subsidiary targets is the sum of your target, and I, as a principal, have set that target for you as a regional manager, as a supervisor. So they don't have a choice to distribute it over there.
So the manager isn't setting levels, he's just setting the composition so that it equals the sum of some predetermined hurdle.
Yes, because the levels the supervisor can influence that in this negotiation process. That's where she can influence these levels, but not after that. Once this target has been set for the region, she has no choice. That's her target, and she has to distribute it among the subsidiaries. Yes.
Okay, so I could see a kind of complicated model where you're trying to figure out who's the most sensitive, and then if you think it's unreasonable, crank up the target for the person that's the least sensitive and hone everybody else in. But I couldn't necessarily solve that problem.
One thing that we do see is that for those men, if they did not make it to the target, and the ones that did not make to the regions that did not make it to the target, that actually they set the target for their for the managers that were able in the last period to so the agents that did make it to the target in the last period, they set them in, you know, quite a difficult target in terms of the, you know, target development. So we do see that. Yeah.
And does the manager have any cost to doing this? In that if the manager has some productive capabilities, do they involve any kind of opportunity cost or search cost in tweaking these particular targets?
So I'm not sure what I know what you mean. Can you repeat your question?
Yeah, if only if the subsidiaries are making profit, mm-hmm. My question is irrelevant. But if the manager is actually doing something so that they can increase net operating income, is there an opportunity by setting targets taken away from their productive capabilities?
So what happens is that the regional manager and the subsidiary managers, they sit together very often, right, to discuss potential improvements in performance, right? So in that sense, the regional manager is helpful, but that's all that they can do. They cannot take out resources or anything, or remove or add resources to the subsidiary.
So there's no opportunity cost for doing this then. Okay, thank you.
And all the targets are sales targets, so there's no profit targets in this involved. Yeah. Okay. So when we look at this monthly targets that are the end product, if you like, of this whole process, we consider these monthly targets to be, you know, at the regional subsidiary as an equilibrium outcome of this target setting process in the way that I tried to describe that. So the role of, thank you, Timothy, the role is I already alluded to in answering the question that Timothy had. So what's the role of the regional managers then? Right, the regional manager, they monitor, and they actually also act as an information intermediary between the agents, you know, and the highest principal in the firm. They process information and share that, so that the target setting process can become easier, is enhanced. So the other is that they create incentives. So they have regular meetings with the agents. So the supervisor and the regional manager have regular meetings where they discuss performance and also discuss potential for improvements of performance that they discuss with their agents, with the subsidiary managers. And all of that is then with the idea that, and in the end, of course, that they can set attainable targets. So again, difficult, but not too difficult targets, so that subsidiary managers are motivated as good as possible. So, yes.
Yeah, sorry, Jan, yes. Can I ask a clarification question?
Sure.
Yeah, so I'm trying to understand in your setting, what is the role of cooperation among these subsidiaries? Is there anything that that entails cooperation? Because that would take us to a relative target setting kind of a kind of a scenario. So just to understand what's the setting here.
So what happens in stage two is that in stage two, there's discussion between the regional manager and head office, headquarters of this division, about, you know, what are reasonable targets, right? So there's a discussion and there's information exchange between the two. Then in the end, headquarters decides, you know, for the region manager, this is your target. And they also decide at the same point in time, this is going to be also the target for the individual subsidiaries, but you can still talk about that. You cannot change your target as a region, but you can still talk about these subsidiary managers. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, so the subsidiaries know among each other that their relative targets.
They know about a zero sum game. If that's nice.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. All right. So what we try to do is you know, we look at the idea would be, you know, that we are looking at supervisory target achievement. Is that going to affect how these supervisors are setting targets for these agents? And to do that, we measure the target achievement of the supervisor. So how well does he or she, we call it a C in the paper, achieve the target. And the dependent variable here is the target update. To what extent is that explained by past performance, so actual minus target performance? So that is how we operationalize with, you know, kind of controls that we, of course, also introduce. So when we think of the variables involved and how we measure that, so we have at the region, we have 60 observations in each year. This is the actual sales, this is the targeted sales, and here you see the differences between those, and this is for the subsidiaries. So we have 2,160 observations, months observations, I should say, for the subsidiaries, and we have 360 for the region. So how do we try to measure whether there's support in this data for the hypothesis that we have? So the first question is, you know, does supervisor performance explain how they set the targets for their agents? And how we measure this is the extent to which this past performance, does it really explain the current target, so the target that the subsidiary is facing now, conditional on what was the previous performance of the superior? Did she achieve her target or not? Is that going to determine, you know, how much past performance plays a role in setting that target for the subsidiary for the next period? We also look at serial correlation for the agent. So we look at serial correlation. Is serial correlation, which points to, you know, how the targets are set and how much information is impounded, because if there's totally serial correlation, right, there's not a lot of information going in, because, you know, that seems to suggest that they always make it to the target or they never make it to the target, and that it is totally correlated over time. And we expect actually that will be the case to a lesser extent if information is being used. So that's the second way that we try to understand, you know, whether the data supports our hypothesis, looking at the serial correlation. Because if it is the case that not achieving the target leads the supervisor to change, to adapt the method of setting the target, she is implicitly using information more efficiently. So you expect then the serial correlation to deteriorate, to decrease. We also do additional analysis where we look at the extent to which the supervisor uses different types of information to set the target. So next to past information in the sales target, also additional information that might be informative about the sales potential. And we also look at the extent to which the target is registered of the supervisor, so the regional manager herself. So this is how we try to establish this. So first, we look at we didn't do a regression. This looks at the adjustments. So what we see here is, did the regional manager achieve the target, so meet the target, or did she miss the target? And what we are particularly interested in is that, you know, if the subsidiary missed the target, right? If many of them did, then the regional manager missed her target as well. If a few of them did, right, that is not necessarily going to lead the regional manager not to meet the target, because there can be sufficient subsidiary managers that still reach the target, so that the regional manager can still reach the target despite the fact that not all sub-managers have achieved the target. So the expectation is that if a subsidiary has missed the target, right, that target is not going to be changed too much in the sense that if a sub-manager missed the target, it's not necessarily the case that her target will be decreased in the next period because she now missed the target. Actually, we know from quite some evidence that is not the case, and we call it asymmetric ratcheting. On the other hand, when the subsidiary missed the target, and many of them missed the target, which is the case when the regional manager does miss the target, then we expect a reduction in their target, sales target, a lower sales target. And that is actually what we find here. And that difference is significant as well. So that is what we expected to happen. We also look at relative targets. So within each region, we look at the relative target for the managers in each particular region. And what we see is that when the target is set relatively difficult, what we see here is again that a reduction in the target is associated with the regional manager missing the target in the previous period. And that difference is also significant. So this is only, you know, some first evidence to support our ideas. And we also looked at it, so this is also descriptive data using graphs. So this is the absolute target adjustment, the change in the target based on their achievement. So what you see here is this, so the blue line and the red line. The blue line represented the subsidiary met the target, and the regional manager also met the target. And here is it that the subsidiary missed the target and the regional manager met the target. So the red line, right, is this reflects this idea that, you know, if you miss a target as a sub, that is not going to mean that next period time that you get a lower target. That is this line also not suggesting, and that is also, you know, not what's happening. What you can expect that if you did reach a target, that your target will be registered in the next period. And that's exactly what we see here, here with the blue line. Now, what we expect and what we see here is indeed that if the regional manager missed a target, that's a yellow line and the green line, that then the target setting is moving more directly to past performance as the point of reference. So the past performance of the individual agent is indeed a very important determinant, gets a high weight in setting the next period target. Now we also looked at the regional, sorry, at the when the we also looked at the relative target setting. So what we see is that if the region missed the target for failing regional measures, we see a negative association between a more negative association between relative difficult performance and target updating compared to where the regional target is met. So this is the first regression we did, and this is only a part of the total table. You will see the full table in the in our paper, but I just highlighted the most important part. So what we see here is the target adjustment from the past period to the next period. That is over here, and this is where the region met the target, and this is where the region target was missed. And here we have all observation. So what we basically see here, that is what I would like to emphasize here, is if the regional manager has met the target versus when they have missed the target, right? What we observe is indeed that the extent to which the past performance is impounded in the next period target is higher in case that the target was missed compared to where the target was met. What we also see is that relative target setting, right? It is negative here in all observations, reflecting already that, you know, when it is a difficult target that it gets imparted to a lesser extent. But that is especially the case when the regional target is missed, actually. So this is support for our hypothesis that this past information gets impounded to a higher extent when the regional manager missed her target. What happens when we look at serial correlation? I forgot to mention that we also looked at additional information that you can use to set the target, because the target can be set based on past information, but can also be based on additional information coming from some examination, investigation that you do. And in this case, we look at the number of working days that are available. And what we observe actually that if the number of days that are available for work, if that changes, that information is used it's used in general, right? It is used to a higher extent actually when the target is met compared to when the target is missed. In other words, the importance of other information decreases as soon as they miss the target, because that suggests that using that information by the supervisor to set the target is not informative enough to be impounded as much as they did in the past, because that is not leading to an accurate target, given that they missed the target, right? I mean the regional manager. Yes, please. Yes, here.
Yeah, so I'm just trying to understand the test better. So sure. Now you divide the sample between targets met and targets not met. So I'm just wondering, do you also examine in the paper how far the managers or the subsidiaries are away from the targets? So because I can see that the further away from the target, then the target may not be that useful, then they will more likely to rely on previous performance, perhaps.
So this is the size of the difference between that is determining the next period target. So we look at the size of the difference in here, and this just looks at, you know, did you as a regional manager achieve your target or not? So this is a 1 or 0.
Okay.
And if many of them, you know, so it's, you know, so the sum of the target achievement of the individual agents, right? The sum of that is determining whether this is 1 or 0, basically.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So that is impound. Is that answering your question?
Yeah. So it's already in the test. So how far they are away from the achieving the targets?
Well, do you mean the regional manager or the studio manager?
I mean the regional. So how far away they are from the targets?
No, that's not in here. This is about whether they achieved it or not.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I'm just wondering.
It's a dummy.
Yeah. So do you consider to, is it possible to change dummy to a continuous variable to see?
I have to look into that. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. So the next test that we did is to look at serial correlation. So we look at the subsidiary. So DS is, you know, did the subsidiary achieve the target or not in the current period? And to what extent is that dependent of them achieving their target in the previous period, T minus one. And why do we think that's important? I mean, if you look at the target setting literature, the idea is that actually you should set a target where there's basically no serial correlation between one achieving one target in one period and achieving the target in the next period. Because if that is the case, that implies that you are not using the information that is contained, that is available very efficiently. So, and that's actually what we are looking at here. So this is where the regional target is met. So the regional target is met. And what we see here that there is a high serial correlation between the two. That changes. So in other words, the information used to set the target changes. That changes when the regional target is missed. So then this is broken down, this serial relation between the subsidiary achieving the target or missing the target in one period and achieving or missing the target in the next period. So that again would suggest that, you know, the way that information is used is changing. And we see that here also reflected in this interaction when we look at all observations, where we find this negative relationship. If we combine regional manager achieving her target or not, and the subsidiary manager reaching his target or not. We also look at levels here. So here we look at the level of difference between the target achievement in the current period, to the extent to which that is explained by the regional manager achieving the target or not, or the subsidiary manager target achievement or not. So when we run the regression like here, for the subsidiary manager achieving the target and how that is, or not her target and his target, and the difference between the actual and the target, right? You see this negative relationship coming up here. However, as soon as we start introducing also what the regional manager has achieved, we're going to make a difference between managers that achieve the target and not achieve the target. And then it's going to really affect how this the reason manager is going to evaluate the achievement. And what we observe then is that there's actually this, that there's a negative relationship here when the reason manager did not achieve the target. And this one, so whether or not the subsidiary manager achieved the target, disappears, which is pretty much consistent with the previous budgeting literature, right? That when a manager is unable to achieve the target, you're not going to reduce the target in the next period. That's pretty much reflected here. And here we find when that does happen, and it does happen when the regional manager did not achieve the target. In other words, the regional manager was unable to set achievable targets for the full range of agents she is responsible for. So now she has to change her target setting approach. We're pretty much getting too close. So I only have 4 minutes left, I see. So I will speed up a little bit. Lastly, we also looked at the use of information, and we look at two models then, and we look at, you know, we calculate the target based just on this past performance. So we calculate a target based on only past information, and we calculate the target based on past information and other information, like the number of working days that are available. And the idea would be that when you look at the target, how it is set in this period, how it is set in this period, right? That the extent to which you achieve the target in the next period, that should be become related to a lesser extent over time. And that's what we test here. And is it the case that if we impound only past information, that you then get, you know, better, that you then use information better? Or is it the case that you use information better when you use both past performance information and other information? And to test that, you want actually this coefficient to be as low as possible. And that's actually what we observe here, that this coefficient of actual minus target is indeed becoming lower if you only use past information to look at this missed target. So we observe there a relationship that is consistent with our hypothesis. Then target setting for the regional manager. So now we go from the agent one level up to the regional manager. How is the target set for the regional manager? For the regional manager, we see that if all of the subs have missed their target, right, that then the target of the subsidiary manager is reduced. Sorry, of the regional manager is reduced, but only then. If only few of the subsidiary managers were unable to achieve the target, that is not going to trigger headquarters to reduce the target. So it's only in the case that the region manager did not achieve the target and all of the subs have missed the targets that actually he gets a relief from headquarters. Only then. So what are the conclusions? I got 1 minute. So previous evidence suggests that superiors tend to ignore at first performance by setting targets for their agents. However, when supervisors, is it the case that if supervisors are unable to achieve their target, are they then no longer ignoring at first performance, but actually impound that in the next period target? And that's what we find. So superiors who miss their target make more strongly use of agents past absolute performance, and actually also for relative performance, but I haven't been able to talk much about that, to set the agent's target. Particularly in case the supervisor misses their own target, they reduce the use of other information to inform target setting. So they use past information more and they use other information less because they were unable in the past, they have been unable in the past to transform that other information well enough in a good target for the next period. Of course, this is evidence that was collected in only one firm. So, you know, whether this is totally generalizable to the whole world, I cannot claim that. We do test solid theory. So in that sense, the data behaves as theory would predict. So in that sense, it is, I guess, generalizable. So I have questions here. So I don't know, Mohamed, whether we still have time, but this is the presentation that I have for today. That's actually
Thank you very much, dear Professor Jean, for this excellent presentation. Thank you very much. Now, if anyone have any questions, you can open your mic and ask your question. Lou, you can ask.
Okay. Hello, I just have two questions. And first, I just wonder if you have any information on the like target setting process, like because we know that the target setting like mainly based on some theoretical performance, past performance, and the peer performance. Yes. I just wonder that if you have any information on like how do the corporations set up their targets, like to what percentage they rely on the theoretical performance, like from consultants or based on the theoretical performance from business models, or like to what percentage based on the peer performance versus the past performance. I just wonder like if the supervisors do have the discretion in the target setting process, and how they're gonna exercise their discretion in this process. Another question is about so we know that also the managers may revise their targets after the performance period. We know that in this setting we may not be able to examine the target revision process, but what do you think, like if the current year's the firm's current year's target setting is quite sticky to the previous year's target setting, but they may like make some changes to the end of the performance period and to revise the targets, and also to the performance evaluation process. That's my question. Thank you.
Thank you, Jay. Two things. So the first is to do with, you know, what kind of information is important. That's why I pulled up this slide again, right? So what we see is actually that all kinds of information are used. So the past information is used, other information like the number of working days is being used, and also relative information is being used, right? That is all going into the process and leads to this mix of information that then leads to the target. So it's a mix. So they use the mix. So they use all three kinds of performance relevant information that you mentioned. So that's one. They make no changes throughout the years, and that has to do that they don't want to get in politics throughout the year, right? The target is the target, and we're not going to discuss that. Is that right? I mean, I don't know that. I mean, that is just the outcome, right? And I have to accept that. That is how they decide that they can best manage the firm. So I hope that answers a little bit your question, but yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you for your question.
Is there another questions? If anyone have any questions, you can open your mic and ask your question. Professor Tim?
Yeah, I want to preface this by saying I am not an econometrician, but if we could go to the slide with the regressions for those who failed to meet their target and those who met.
You mean this one?
Yeah, okay, so let's just think about 2A and 3A.
Right.
Do you solve, okay, yeah. Now, since the sum of targets have to equal the manager's targets, mm-hmm. their decision in 2A and 3A is obviously not independent. Those are interlaced. Do you solve those simultaneously or independently?
We calculate them here independently, but not here. So here they are in one heap, right? So the only thing that we do here is, I mean, we do the full regression here. When we look at this full regression, this already suggests that it makes a difference whether this regional manager did or did not achieve her target. So that led us to make this to do these regressions separately.
Would it be maybe? Could you throw a dummy and interaction in there to solve it all simultaneously? I realize it would be cluttered and hard to read that way, but at least you're not violating the independence of 3A and 2A.
So what would that W be then, Tim? Yes.
Whether the regent met or missed.
But that's, yeah, but that's what we do here, right?
That's what you do there, but only if 2A and 3A are solved simultaneously, right?
So here we just throw in all observations at the same time.
In 1A, right?
In 1A and 1B, yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
But then when you go to 2A, you're only looking at those who met, and then 3A, only those who missed.
That's right.
But since I'm, as a manager, I have to set the sum of those to equal something, those are not independent decisions from the regional manager. So I'm wondering, are those really independent regressions? Can you solve them independently like you've done?
Yeah.
That's my question. And yes, I don't know the answer to this.
I have to think about that too.
I would be willing to be educated.
Yeah, no, I have to think about this too. And I will get back to you when I have solved the problem. I will send you an email. Because I
appreciate that.
Yes, I will do that. Yes, thanks.
Any other question? If anyone have any questions, you can open your mic and ask your question.
Hello.
Hi.
Thank you for this nice presentation. I have a question about the target setting process. Professor Timothy earlier asked a question about whether the setting target is dependent on the opinion of regional managers, and if this is correct, you professor answered him that it's depending on the recommendation for them, once accepted, once binding to the regional manager.
Okay, so that's the negotiation, that's right.
Yes, what I need to ask here is region target met, can we consider this as an indicator that their participation here is real, not apparent?
There's participation in a way in a negotiation process. So when we look at stage two, right? Here there's a lot of influencing, if you like. After stage two, there's no influencing anymore between the regional manager and headquarters. That stops. There's still some influencing between the subsidiary managers and the regional managers about what will be the final target for the sub-managers. And once that is established, there's no negotiations then anymore also. So once the target for the year is set and divided over the month, there's no negotiations possible anymore.
Okay, I understand it. Thank you.
Thank you.
There is another question.
Please.
If anyone have any questions, you can open your mic and ask your question. Thank you very much, dear Professor Jean, for your contribution and your effort. It's really an excellent presentation. Thank you very much. And it's all that remains for me to say is thank you for everyone that's joined us. And I thank you very much for taking the time out to present to us today, dear Professor Jean. It's been really appreciated. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mohammed, for organizing all this. And thank you for the audience. I applaud for you. Thank you very much for being here. I really enjoyed presenting. I hope it was a bit clear. And if you have questions, please put them on the mail if you want to. But I will get back to this. And again, thank you and have a very nice weekend.